Yeah, why don't we go through those questions if.
One of the things that I wanted to board over at Gateway, and we're finding a lot of students coming out of KUSD need remedial math, English, and basic stuff.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm over at Gateway as an advisor, and we're having lots of problems with the students coming in there and not being prepared for math and English, and just doing a lot of remedial stuff. And we have to do a better job of educating our kids, because that's the one, that these are trade school kids.
Yep.
And that's the people I employ.
Yeah, and what many folks don't understand is that the technical trades, often the academic background, is higher than what it's required for college entrance. The best way to address that is to backload off of what they need and embed that.
Madison.
Yep, yeah, all those, and they're not going to be all that far, but you start looking at that and making clear so everybody sees that, from the kindergarten teacher right up through the system, this is where we're trying to get kids. And then have identified at each grade level what mastery looks like, so that everybody's moving towards mastery. And that really has to become the norm, is that kids don't move through the system unless they've mastered the content. And I've heard your faculty have shared that there's no consistently standard expectation about mastery in this district. And you move to mastery, you will start moving, changing the outcomes here. Because when grades are based not on what they know and can do, but whether on compliance and so forth, it's not really doing, it's not fair to the kids. So moving towards that mastery approach, some call it standards-based grading or assessment, where you're clearly following that student through. You can put that into your student information system, so you can have a record of what the kid knows and what they can do. And then be thinking about helping kids before the learning, giving them the interventions beforehand. And I think that's one of the tensions with, you get response to the interventions and so forth. It's about fixing the problem after the problem.
Yeah.
When you have an opportunity to correct it. Now, that's not to say that some kids aren't going to need intensive work to help them be successful. But we can change that dynamic and really help 90 to 95% of kids be successful by getting more on the front end and holding kids accountable for mastery. That way, as the kids move through the system, when they move into that middle school from three elementary schools, the teachers have clear expectation. You know, I know you had this. I saw your scores. We're going to do a quick review, and then we're moving on. You hold kids accountable for their learning. It'll be amazing what they can remember.
Yeah.
But we create a system where it's okay to play like I don't know this.
Mm-hmm.
And we get wrapped up in this whole system, and it just progresses throughout the system.
And that is key with getting them to take that on, because the kids that do that are the ones that are successful when they internalize it and take that on, because they'll keep track of their grade point average, and they know exactly where they're at.
Yeah.
Speaking as a parent, yeah, from a parent that's got a lot of understanding on that issue. Okay, I have questions. It says, will this audit be posted on the website? And I think
it already is.
All right.
And I'd recommend that when the plan, your plan for implementation of addressing the audit findings and recommendations, you put that on the website. And how you're going to measure that, put it on the website. And quarterly reporting, put it on their website.
So once that six-month period is up, you come back to us with recommendations, and then it's a discussion with the board. The board, does the board vote to approve that plan?
I would approve the plan.
Okay.
As an operational plan, because there's a financial connection to,
yep,
it, and also a monitoring piece to it.
And then after all that process is done, then it would be posted on the website. Okay.
That's what I would recommend.
Okay. Again, I'm talking about individual policies, and without, you know, having that understanding the connectedness to policies, how should, you know, I know some of our policies overlap. I believe you've identified the policies. I see that in this. So when we're moving forward for policy change, based on what you talked about, looking at those items that need immediate attention, should we be looking at those policies that are connected to that, so that it's, I'm trying to figure out how we connect it all. So,
yeah.
Because if our policies are supporting that, I think that we'll get the movement we need.
Yeah.
In the right direction.
Yeah. In the recommendation, there's a piece on your policy development piece. to create more structure around that piece. And starting off, and this is just my attempt to make a graphic representation of what's in the recommendation, is identifying the need for the policy. Where is it being driven from? Why do we need to change the policy? What's changed? So we know what we're tackling. Then the policy committee, once they identify this is a policy that needs to be either need a new policy or one redrafted, here's what we're looking for, here's our expectations. Then that goes to the superintendent and their leadership team to do the research, the drafting, and so forth. And they bring that back to the policy committee. And it may go back and forth between the policy committee and the superintendent's leadership team as wordsmithing and so forth. And then it comes to the full board for that first reading. With full understanding, it may go right back to a draft and go right back to the leadership team. So it kind of goes back and forth. And until you're completely ready to take that second reading and then disseminating the policy. But by having those, what I'm recommending here is that the superintendent would identify a policy owner. So let's say it's a policy around facilities. Well, probably your director of plant services is the one who should be the owner of that, mm-hmm. who facilitates the research, drafting it, getting out consulting with those who are going to be impacted, yep. rewriting it and bringing it back to the leadership team. They're going to certainly look at it from a perspective, okay, legally, statutorily, connectiveness to the other policies, so kind of finds smoothing out those pieces, and then to the board, policy committee, and then finally to the board. It's going to take probably more time to develop policies than what you might be experiencing now, mm-hmm. Because of the time spent really tightening it up, rewriting it, fine-tuning it. But I think when you're done, you're going to have a better set of policies that are clear, and again, they're to guide decision-making of your staff. So anybody should be able to pick it up and really have a clear sense, this is what the board's expecting. Now, the day-to-day functions of how to do that is where the superintendent has to develop those rules and regulations to support that. Okay. So hopefully that helps. But
how can we use a new DPI dues report to help improve student learning for our high-risk students and close that gap? Now, the dues report, this is new, so it's to identify students that are at risk and I would think become proactive. So that, I'm just throwing that out there because I think that's a piece that could be very effective in helping us identify.
And really ought to be expecting what are each building principal doing to address that.
So
the effectiveness within their buildings, identifying kids who need interventions, what kind of interventions are they working. I mean, principals need to be held accountable at a much higher level for changing the student dynamics and their achievement in their building.
I think that's huge, too, now that we have that report. And I was so excited to learn about it that, you know, a follow-up plan I think will be really helpful for us to, maybe that's a piece that needs to be put right into our strategic planning and goals that we have set. I think that'll help close our achievement gap. Okay. Don't different schools have different needs? How does this fit into a plan? Same for professional development. Do all need the same?
Yes and no. It's a yes and no piece. You allow the differentiation when the building can show that their needs are different. But if their needs are the same as the rest of the organization, because you are going to have buildings that have slightly different needs. Mm-hmm. So you let them address that. But it needs to be driven by the data.
How do we make sure then that that board policy is the guiding direction for a superintendent, for our leadership team, so that, you know, what's the check and balance system for us in the decision-making process?
The check and balance is, it's up to the superintendent to implement that policy as it's written and to ensure that it's done within the system. So if a policy is being implemented incorrectly or was not applied correctly, then the superintendent needs to be held accountable for that, because that's their responsibility. So again, that's where you stay in that governance stage, because you're holding them accountable.
I know, that's it.
You call them to task. If it wasn't done right, call them to task and then ask, okay, how are we going to prevent this from happening again? Maybe the policy wasn't written very clear and led to the confusion. Or maybe it was not communicated clearly. There's so many things that can go wrong. But you hold the superintendent accountable for that. They then have to hold their staff accountable for it. So you don't get into the management side and telling them how and when and where.
And I think that's the piece where it's confusing too, because of, and again, you might have nailed it down the same, the way the policy was written, it's not clear enough to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
But it needs to, we need to align it.
Yeah, and that's where with that, this graphic in here, where you get that consultation in there, where you're getting that policy out to those who are going to be implementing it, does it make sense? Is it doable? Is it clear? So you get that feedback. Instead of you drafting a policy here in isolation and then hand it to them and say, here, go implement it, and they're going, there's no way we can.
Right. I mean, I'm not even sure that everybody has it. I don't even know in our district if people refer to our policies at this point, to tell you the truth. I don't know. I don't mean that in a bad way, but I don't know how aware they are, because
ideally, the policy should be something that people are checking all the time. I mean, I always, any major decision, I'm checking to see the policy. Even if I think I know what it is, I'm still checking the policy.
Yeah.
To make sure I'm consistent with decision-making, I'm upholding the expectations of the school board, because that's where you can get in problems when you deviate from the policy.
And that's also board members adhering to the policies that we have created.
Yep.
For governance and, you know, ourselves.
Yeah.
We can't hold other people accountable if we're not adhering to the policies ourselves.
Yeah.
Well, we can hold them accountable, but we need to hold ourselves accountable too, I believe. Parent concerns about all attention doing. I'm sorry, I'm having a hard time reading this one.
I'm going to closing the achievement gap when they want.
Oh, directed at gaps and not. Go ahead and finish it.
We have some parents that are concerned that we're just trying to address the gaps when their child has mastered and they want more depth and knowledge for their child, too.
Well, the reality is if you're moving all your students towards mastery, you're going to find that it's going to change the dynamics in your classrooms considerably. Right now, you got such a wide gap by system design. That's, you got a gap by system design, because you're pushing kids through the system with different interpretations of what it means to pass a course or demonstrate proficiency. And so you're creating that. So you start, and it's not going to happen overnight, you start tightening that up, that expectation around mastery, having systems in place to respond when students don't get the learning the first time, so you don't allow students to fall behind. You will narrow that gap in the classroom. And it's about mastery at high levels. It's just not basic low-level mastery. It's high-level mastery for all kids. And as you move that system up and up and up, you'll find that the boat will keep rising higher and higher and higher. Because you aren't, as a classroom teacher, when you got a gap like this, that is absolutely
hard.
You know, even with differentiation, you only can do so much when you got 30, 35 kids in the classroom. I mean, you just have to be realistic what people can do. So it can happen.
Letting kids sit home without having mastery.
You can't. You can't. You can't.
What do we do?
That's where you have to have a system in place. As a, how are we going to respond to? We're going to have kids who always are going to be moving into the system who are behind where we are.
Not just the ones moving in. Some haven't been in.
Some who've been in, who are behind. How are we going to help them? Those who are falling behind, how are we going to, you have to have systems in place to address that. I would say it's just absolutely malpractice not to make sure every kid's moving. You wouldn't go back to a doctor who just would walk away from treatment and say, well, I tried. You'd have some accountability. I mean, you have to create the systems for it. And it really comes down to system design.
And accountability on everybody's
and accountability,
part.
Yeah.
On that last analogy, some of it's the patient's responsibility.
Well, there,
it's accountability piece.
Yeah, yeah.
I think our students need to understand what we expect of them, too.
Well, we have to show them that we support them. And reading that statistic, inequalities, is really sad.
We can't
to say the least. To say the least, it's very sad.
We don't give up, but a lot of it is in attendance, too.
then you have to ask, I mean, you have to start asking the questions, why aren't kids coming to school? I'll tell you.
Exactly correct.
Not too long ago, I interviewed a group of alternative high school kids who are inclined to walk. And so the question is, why? And frankly, they're saying, this is from perspective of a kid who's 19, 20, 21 years old, trying to get their high school degree in an alternative setting, and basically saying, if the instruction isn't relevant, if I walk in that class that day and it's not connecting with me, I'm out of there. So what are we doing in classrooms to connect with kids? I mean, it's not all on the teacher's side, but we have to create the conditions for kids to learn. And sometimes it has to be looking at it differently. How are we engaging kids? Do they find any value to coming to school? What do you do with the kid that is passing all their tests but aren't doing any of the homework? What's that saying? I mean,
they don't need the homework.
They don't need the homework, but what do we grade them on? What's the grade for the class usually on the homework? It's about compliance most of the time. Where if we had a mastery system, we'd be identifying that kid as somebody who maybe is one who needs enrichment. Mm-hmm. And we're challenging him.
He's bored.
Yeah.
Yeah,
there's a lot of factors, but that's where your leadership, your teachers, and your principals really have to look at it. But if you don't have a system in place of what the expectations are, it's hard to hold anybody accountable, or kids or teachers.
We just kind of sum it up as, oh, they don't want to be at school, they don't this, and then we just kind of let it go, and there's nothing else. We just let it go.
Well, here's a question that's directly related to that. How do you overcome the prejudice, students' histories? I think it's Engel keeping some students. Students.
I can rephrase it. It's my question.
I might be the only one that writes.
When you were talking about keeping records that a teacher could tap into the records of a former student, my question was, how do you overcome the prejudice angle when you keep student histories? Some students and parents and teachers don't want to know the history because then they prejudge the student and expect certain behaviors or expect certain things from them rather than starting off with a fair shot.
Ooh, with a clean slate, so to speak.
Yeah.
My response would be is that we have to maintain a level of professionalism and expect a professional level of service from our faculty. You can accept that from a physician. That a physician sends somebody to a specialist, they're going to want the records.
Yeah.
What difference is it? I mean, this is the same way. The teacher needs to know where that kid is, and that teacher then assumes responsibility for moving that kid where they are to meeting the goals and expectations of the system.
I understand what you're saying. It's just that, but if you have certain level of expectations, then you may be limiting the student yourself, if that's what you expect from that student.
And I think that's where the rich opportunities with the professional learning communities, really where teachers can work collaboratively to challenge each other.
If you work in a team.
We're working in fifth grade team. We're looking at the kids. We're looking at how they're performing. We're looking at which one of us is getting better results. Mm-hmm. What can we learn from each other? I mean, that level of collaboration is a powerful tool that has not been really tapped yet. And you're just scratching the surface right now.
It was a concern that I've heard from parents that, well, this is what you expect from my child
How can the board, as far as the long-term and short-term goals, when we do our planning for the goals, how can we, define what should be a short-term and a long-term goal to put out there?
I think your vision is going to help identify what your long-term goals are. And then the short-terms are breaking that down into smaller chunks and then looking at how do we move from here to the next step. One of the challenges a lot of organizations do is they set these the annual goals or the short-term goals as being too big and expecting these huge performance improvement when reality is it's going to be smaller increments. So set up smaller incremental goals that it's possible that we can get there and people can keep reaching for it and then moving. And instead of setting a goal that they can't, no organization's going to meet, everybody fails, so they give up. So it's that art of finding where to find that tension point where it keeps people engaged and motivated and where it's a disincentive.
Okay.
So it's a balancing act, and you have to just keep monitoring what's working, what isn't working, and using that feedback loop to make adjustments to your goals. And there's nothing wrong with changing a goal. You're into it halfway through, and you go, geez, this is, just wasn't the right goal. So we go to a different one, or a new goal emerged out of this one that actually is a layer below it. Mm-hmm. But if you don't have that feedback loop coming back, and you're constantly not sitting down as a board, at least quarterly with your leadership team, and doing a deep dive on the metrics of this organization and what we value, you're never going to have information to know if you're on the right target or not, or even have the right goals in place.
Sort of like looking at your GPS and seeing where the heck you are. Yep.
Yeah.
You don't know where you are, you can't get to where you want to go.
Yeah.
Quarterly.
Yeah.
With the whole, you said something that just, the quarterly meetings with leadership council.
You do this in business all the time. I don't know why we don't do this in education. This is standard operating mm-hmm. procedure for a business.
When you said quarterly meetings with the leadership council to kind of reevaluate where we are and look, reviewing the goals and getting updates on things, I think that's very important, but it needs to be with the whole board and the whole leadership council. I think that's important that all parties are involved.
And doing yep. deep dive and yes. not being afraid to ask why.
Yep, yep.
Why? To what end?
Yep.
Why is this happening?
Yep.
Yeah. What do we have to do to change to make it happen?
I would think our priorities will be in response to, obviously, the areas that we need. I would think that our priorities will align with what mm-hmm. comes back, obviously, is the highest needs area. And we know the achievement gap is a huge area, along with many others. But I would imagine that our mm-hmm. short and long-term goals will be based around that, too. Let's see if this was already answered. So, again, going back to how do we communicate as a board that, and how do we make sure that the communication, the implementation, and the management are set and have the proper time allowance so we can reach these goals and that there's clarity around everything so that everyone understands the plan. So I think you kind of touched on that a lot.
Yeah, it's you have to rely on your management to be yes. fair and honest. And if you set an expectation, except when they come back and say, we've done an analysis and we just can't get to this point because these pieces are missing or we don't have the time. We can get you here, but we can't get you here. And accept that and in partnership, look at making a revision or a recalibration of where you're going. It's a give and take process all the way through. In terms of communicating, you can't over communicate. And in all different ways. You know, the website's one way, internal messaging, video clips. I mean, there's so many different ways that you can communicate. And the more you communicate and consistently about where you're going, what is the message, and a lot of my leadership team meetings is at the end, we sat down and what are the key talking points out of this meeting today that we will share with everybody. And my leadership teams, I had the union president and everybody, so we sat down with our PR person and literally hammered out the talking points for the day's decisions. Mm-hmm. And then everybody was using those same talking points across. But it was a collaborative process of doing that. At the end of bargaining sessions. I mean, you can do this in many, many different ways. End of a board meeting. Come up with a set of four or five, what are the key things that we accomplished as a board tonight? That's our talking points that we communicate. So just having a good, solid communications plan in place is really, and sticking to it, using it, you can't over-communicate. And that's usually where organizations get in problems. People just don't know. And you just can't assume because you put it in a newsletter or you put it in the minutes that people saw it. They don't.
Yeah.
You just have to say it a million different times, a million different ways, and different times, and just keep at it. But getting that consistency.
And those talking points, I think, are very effective.
And at the end of each of these key meetings, this is what we accomplished. This is what we decided. This is what we're doing next. And boom, and you just keep moving on.
Is it wise to use Title I and Title II funds solely for job positions, I believe?
Technology, or can be used for job positions?
I think, and this is my own personal opinion, how I saw Title I dollars being expended in this district, I'd have a high concern because so much of it is being spent on technology and software.
How about Title II?
Title II is generally professional development. And that could be coaching. I mean, there's a lot of different things, instructional coaches, different programs.
In the past, we've kind of been instructed not to use title money because, and I forget if it's one or two, for jobs, because if that title money runs out, so does that position.
You can carry over a certain amount of title dollars. I mean, there's a limit on how much, so you can always have a cushion there so that you aren't having to just pull a plug, because invariably it's going to come back.
Of course.
If you look historically, title monies haven't changed that much over time, and what changes have been fairly incremental.
Okay.
So hold some back, and I actually think if you're really looking at moving student achievement, it's going to be teachers working with kids.
That's right.
That teachers with very highly specialized skills. So if you're focusing on reading, I'd be looking for somebody who is really good at diagnosing reading and able to design interventions for that student that can move them very quickly back on the track. Frankly, folks, and this is just my own opinion, I don't think buying a software program is going to solve it, or putting a kid in front of a computer is going to solve it. It needs to be a highly skilled professional. My sense is you're using your software stuff way too much as a surrogate teacher. Kid didn't get in my classroom, sent it down the hallway to the computer lab or onto a computer. That's not going to solve it, and as we've demonstrated, not all these programs are good programs, and they do require the professional expertise of a teacher to purposefully select what software, what application, not just a blanket piece. So there is a role for some kids, but it has to be very purposefully designed to meet the needs of that student, and where some other strategy wasn't effective. But frankly, if I was looking at with some of your buildings, with the amount of title dollars they have, I could be doing a lot in terms of impacting student achievement other than buying technology. That's my own personal opinion, but...
But each building has their own decision of how they're going to spend that.
But you can set...
So we could set...
Parameters.
I would set parameters.
So that's where we can come in as a board to kind of, you know, encourage.
I'd set parameters on this, and actually coming up with a written set of parameters. These are acceptable means of using your Title I dollars to gain biggest impact. If you want to deviate from those, then you must prepare a written proposal, presentation, and documentation that it has a likelihood to impact it.
It's interesting that you're saying this, because I just had some kids from high school talk to me about how the dynamics have shifted to more online, and how much they absolutely hate it. And it's not because they don't think it has a place, but they feel like they're being, that's what everything is about for them. And they're at the high school level, and they desperately, and I think this is a group of high-risk kids, and they desperately need that interaction to help guide and direct them, not just these programs. That
and again,
who do you think is responsible? Who's responsible for the students getting into that technology at that point? Don't you think it's the teacher's responsibility in that classroom?
I think it's what we've seen. It's a multitude of things in the organization. And one
we
is
have shifted a lot of our
decision making to that level. There's no component in there of vetting those online resources to see if they even align with what we're trying to accomplish, and when is the condition that they're most effective, and looking at what the other districts, has it made a difference, what is the research? I'd be asking for the research data to see it, that this works with this particular
and
type of student,
in
this type of situation.
So
it's being more purposeful about so selecting and using it, but if it's just an automatic, that's the go-to, after one level of instruction doesn't work, what evidence do you have that it's working? If you have evidence that it's working, maybe that's the right thing to do. But absence of that evidence, I'd be asking a lot of questions. And that's really a role for the board to not be afraid to ask those tough questions. It's not about getting into management, but what evidence do you have this is going to likely work in your school? Where have you seen it work? What data and research have you piloted it? When are you going to make a decision whether it's effective? We're suggesting within at least 3 years you're making a decision, this is right or this is wrong, you pull the plug and reinvest those resources someplace else. But that could even be an instructional program with a teacher, too. That could be a great idea, but for whatever reasons, not the right match, the right mix for our organization, have to drive it with the data. Otherwise, what happens with organizations, you just keep adding positions, and you get this overload of positions out there that aren't having a direct impact on changing student achievement. Retool it, reallocate those resources to something that you know it's going to work. And more often than not, many districts get way, way too many interventions in place, and they don't even know how many they have in place. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And frankly, if your leadership team can't tell you very succinctly, these are the key initiatives in our district, and these are the results, then you got too many. Because how do you manage that as an organization? Again, it's where are you putting your resources, what is going to make a difference in terms of student achievement, and just keep coming back to that, how it's going to be, because there's a lot of nice stuff out there,
yeah,
a lot of stuff people can get passionate about, but if it's not working, it's not working, no matter how much you like it. Yeah.
I want to go back to Rosetta Stone.
Mm-hmm. Actually, that's on the next question here, so if you let me finish. Because time is scarce and we have so many teaching objectives, should leadership look at eliminating some of the programs we have adopted, such as Tell Me More, Rosetta Stone, thereby making more time before, or taking those programs, making them a before or after program or something, but allowing that time for the teachers to get our kids to that point and not distracting from those goals of the reading and the math and the science and
Go back to what was the goal that you were trying to accomplish when you implemented those programs, and how are we going to measure that, and then take a look. Are we moving towards accomplishing that goal? And you have to make an evaluation. Is it working or isn't it working? We didn't evaluate the effectiveness. All we looked at was alignment and saying, is it likely aligned with the Common Core? It's not. But you may have had other reasons for implementing. So go back to what was your original reason for implementing it, how were you going to measure that, and if you didn't have an idea how you're going to measure it, what would be an acceptable evidence that it was an effective investment of our money in accomplishing a goal? And then you have to make a decision at some point and set a date. By this point, either it's working or isn't working.
And Dr. Pugh, that's not just for those two.
It's all.
Because those two weren't really for the benchmark that you were talking about, the standard that you had mentioned in your slide. But that's for all programs. That's not just for these two. That's
correct.
For anything that
those
we're doing.
Those are just two that you mentioned.
Yeah.
Yeah, that we should really be taking a hard look at to ensure they're aligned and if they're accomplishing the goal that we have set.
Mm-hmm.
I think the key is allowing it time to progress. I think sometimes we react too quickly,
yep.
And we don't have data to really support, or enough data to support removing a program. So it's interesting that you said it again, giving it time, at least 3 years to come to fruition to see if it's really worth having,
mm-hmm.
And that data is the key.
Yeah.
I think, again, though, I go back to that scarcity of time piece, and that's for I know it, especially my experience at the elementary level, there's so much that gets packed into a day.
Oh, yeah.
And if we want the most proficient readers and most proficient students at math, if it's taking away from those core, that because if you could teach,
mm-hmm.
a kid to read and comprehend and cognition,
mm-hmm.
and all the context, all the things that you mentioned with Bloom's taxonomy, I know that they will be able to go out and be problem solvers and do other, and the same thing with math, because it's so important in our society and it's connected,
mm-hmm.
to science. So, again, I think we've got so many initiatives we have to look at. Are we really doing, it's not because those aren't valuable programs, in my opinion, but is it taking away from the overall goal that we want to set,
mm-hmm.
for the board, because there's only so many hours in a day. So.
And it wouldn't certainly not be out of line to have the board ask for reports from, like, your elementary principals.
Mm-hmm.
That we want a concise report from you as a team, or split up by divisions or whatever. But concise reports as a team on these
directly
things.
From the principals.
Yeah, yeah, and do that in a workshop type setting, where you have time to ask questions and so forth, but also being very concise and clear about what it is that you want them to report on.
Sometimes I think you need to involve them in involving their teachers in their evaluation rather than just what they think the response needs to be.
Well, that's what they would do.
That's the principal's job.
That's what the principal would do.
But I think what she's saying is if the teachers are looking at it going, I don't have enough time in the day to get to the mastery level that I want to because there's so many hours and some of these other things are getting in the way, I think.
Yeah, so you can frame that as a board, as just a conversation around instructional time. And talk with your elementary principals to report to you about the use of instructional time in your building.
Yeah.
And just seeing what does it look like? How much time is being allocated? Are we allocating a reasonable amount of time for the core academic areas and still have enough time for the arts and so forth? But that, I think that's a legitimate question for the board as a fact-finding piece, is the same. We have a question about how instructional time is being utilized in our buildings. We want to hear from you. The expectation, you will get this information from your staff. Concise report. And I do it in groups of buildings. It forces them to start working as teams to present a cohesive, collaborative report instead of 20 individual building reports.
That makes sense.
That's just a thought. But there's nothing wrong with having, it's like Congress. You can have a hearing. Ask people to come and present information to you so you can make decisions about, because now that gets starts driving to a policy, because you do have a policy about amounts of instructional time in the core areas.
Yep.
So as you're looking at policy, that may be a very appropriate discussion to have. Are we okay with the policy? Does it need to be refined? What are the inhibitors on this policy? Mm-hmm. And then you got other pieces. Then you want your HR director in there because there's going to be contract pieces and so forth. Right. But you need to have all that information in order to make an informed decision about the direction of the organization.
And I know that one of the things that had happened when they ran out of time for math and reading, at least back many years ago, is recess started getting cut, and kids actually, you know, need to get up and move around and have those brain breaks too. So I think that's a valid way to go about it. How do you overcome top down? Is this yours?
Yeah,
I'm going to ask you to.
Let's see what I said here. One of the things, a lot of the things that we've talked about before are with governance and management. How do you overcome the top-down resistance by staff to get coordination and direction? So in other words, if the board is making all of these issues and then we hand it to management and they make all these issues because we're trying to coordinate all these buildings who are now basically site-based, do you have some strategies to overcome the resistance from top-down management?
Yeah.
Pushback.
Yeah.
Be prepared.
Oh, yeah.
You will always get pushback, and just be prepared for it. However, don't dismiss pushback, because some of that pushback can be very informative about adjustments we need to make. So it's not avoiding the pushback, but listening attentively, but always using the filter of where are we trying to go? Is this helping us inform this decision? But faculty are designed to push back. They should push back on change to make sure we're putting the right changes in place. Now, you want your staff to be consultative. As much as you consult with your leadership team on input and advice, they need to be consulting with their folks, their building principals and so forth, who need to be consulting with faculty. So there should be a lot of consultation taking place before you're moving and making critical decisions as an organization. And even with consultation and making the modifications and adjustments, because new sites, new eyes, new difference of ideas, you're always going to have pushback.
Well, I mean, it just seems that, happens. You know, based on the evaluation, we've been going the direction of more site-based. The evaluation is suggesting we need to go back to more central.
Yeah, on those key things. Yeah. It's very
actually,
central
on
the,
that we were going to site-based.
Very, very tightly held on the curriculum side. Very tight on the curriculum side and accountability for student mastery, but leaving discretion at the building level is how, what instructional practices and how do you get there.
Yeah.
And the more they're successful in demonstrating it, the more looser you can get with that.
Okay.
Now, those who are having trouble, you may have to, on some buildings, have a little tighter framework. But that's where you start differentiating, because you can't treat all 40 buildings the same way.
Well, they have different needs and different clients.
Yep.
Every principal is going to change.
Yep.
That's all the questions that I have here, and I know we have to move
You're out of time
we're
already.
Out of time.
Well, let me just kind of summarize.
Next steps for us as a board is what I would really like to see.
Yeah.
I had two questions, but you answered them.
Oh, yeah.
Nope, you answered them. That's why I waited to submit them.
Let me just kind of maybe try to wrap this whole thing up into a context. I think I'm most impressed about the school system, looking at what this school system has gone through in the last 3 years. I mean, there's been just a tremendous amount of change that isn't all of your doing. Some of it's been imposed. Some of it's been as you've been trying to move the organization in different directions. And yet, we find a passion for people across the district who are willing to work hard. And I've been in a lot of districts that people have been giving up and just counting their days and wanting to go. We didn't sense that. We sense a really high level of professionalism, that people wanted this to be a good school district. Hear it from the board members, hear it from faculty. We saw it with your support staff. We see it with your leadership team. So even though this talks about gaps and discrepancies, and it can be feeling like, oh my goodness, we've got so much to do, I see this as really a lot of hope and optimism that this school system has every potential to really be an outstanding school system. The start, though, is going to happen right here with the 7U, and you will set the direction whether this becomes an outstanding school system or not. Because if the board's not committed to helping move, set the direction, and being very clear in that direction and consistent in that direction, then you're going to slip right back to anything goes. People working hard, good intentions, but everything goes and without any accountability to moving and getting the job done. So next steps, I would strongly recommend working with a facilitator to wrestle with what are your operating norms as a board. As we go forward over the next 6 months of some really big decision making, how are we going to work together? How are we going to address when we disagree with each other? And how are we going to handle when we know we got out of bounds with each other in terms of how we respect each other? You're passionate, strong people. You want great things for your kids. I think this can be an outstanding board if you take that step and do it. And think about this, even though you have elections coming up in April, you're setting a legacy for the future. What you set as the culture, you have the opportunity to start setting the culture for this school board from now on out. And then as you bring new board members on, bring them in. They help enrich the work of the board as new voices, new eyes. But you create a culture around what's important. And it's kids learning. It's us leading with civility and dignity, but clarity and high expectations for everybody. I think if you can accomplish that, this system has everybody out there will make it fly. Because I really sense that there's a lot of energy, a lot of expertise in this school system. And I mean, we were impressed with folks across the system. So leverage that. Use this as a blueprint of how to move forward. And you aren't going to accomplish it all at one time. But I can assure you that if you can do, particularly in the curriculum area, get the feedback loops in, you will start seeing a difference in student achievement. When everybody's on the same page, moving in the same direction, you will start seeing a difference. But also, it'll start shining a brighter light on areas where there are gaps continuing. And the challenge is, how do we address those? And it means as an organization that we have to do something different, because if we keep doing what we've always done, we're going to get the same results. So what are we going to do different as a school organization? Doesn't mean what we did was bad. Doesn't mean that people weren't working hard. We got to get past the blame piece. But as a learning organization, we keep learning and fine-tuning our work and moving forward. I think I'm very, very optimistic for this organization from what I've seen, the passion, the expertise. Now just go do it and have fun doing it. I mean, enjoy the journey. Even though it's going to be tough at times, just enjoy it. I mean, there's a lot of reward and satisfaction to this work, and there is no better, greater work than public education. So that's my speech.
Thank you.
So I thank you for your passion, your work, your questions. You're an impressive group of people. Thank you for spending all afternoon here. I know that's a big commitment on your part. You have jobs and families, and but that's what will make a strong board, is that your commitment to each other and to the organization. So I wish you the very best. And anything I can do to help, you always can call. I won't charge.
Do we have extra copies?
It's on the website.
It's on the website, too.
It's on the website.
On the website.
All right.
It's on a website. They have a PDF copy of it. There's a loose-bound copy, and there's multiple other copies that they have for the leadership team available, so.
It's on the website for the public, right?
Yep.
Well, I was thinking as we move forward,
I'm sure they'll have, the leadership will take care of that, right?
Yeah, so you got some tough decisions to make about, you know, how you're going to move forward.
And a lot of work to do.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'd just like to thank you for bringing clarity and doing all the work that, and understandably that we're not like, I mean, we have a lot of the same issues as many other districts out there, but if we're going to get to the point where we can improve, we all have to work together and move forward, regardless of what's happened in the past.
Exactly, exactly.
Appreciate that.
So, go forth. Best of luck to you, and thank you for all you do for the kids in Kenosha.
Thanks.
I retired in June. Yeah.